Well, the fourth time you guys have seen that transition video. And every time I watch it again, I realize those things are trying to grab our attention all the time. A ton of commands, things demanding us to do stuff or casually, subversively suggesting we do things. The video has been so good for me to think through as we've been doing this university passage, both in fall and spring, because, man, I need to think through what commands am I following. This was really evident to me last night. I was on campus late. I was doing a couple different things before I went over to West Campus, and I was around West Campus. And I want to do something here real quick. I'm not old enough to pull this off, but I want to try it, if that's okay. I need a little help, though. North UTCC, say yes. We got your back. Just say yes. Like 10, I love it, all right. West Campus, hopefully you're saying yes. Front of house, hopefully East Campus, you're saying yes. I want to be a grandparent. I'm not old enough yet. I got a college age daughter, and I got a high school son, but I can't wait to be a grandpa because I'm going to spoil the son. I'm going to be the bad grandpa that does everything that the kids' parents are like, what are you doing, right? But I want to be a grandparent for a second because I love calling things out and spoiling and loving on people and little kids. And last night when I got home, my wife said, how was your evening? I got home at 8 o'clock, so it was a much longer than 5 o'clock evening. And I started telling her about all the things that I saw on campus last night. And if this feels cheesy, I apologize, but it is from the deepest place of my heart, and I really want to make sure that you guys know it. I roamed around campus last night and saw a wide range of students and heard a wide range of conversations. And when I got home and as I was driving home, I couldn't be any more proud. I don't even know if proud's the right word. Any more excited, any more energized than to be a part of this place and your lives. This morning I talked with a student and I forgot her name. There are so many names. There are so many of you. I apologize. But you know what? I may not know your whole story or your name, but man, when I see you guys work hard, finish strong, do things, there's crazy plays like Hairspray. There's baseball players that are traveling up to Utah to play games. I overheard some students talking about their experiences in Mexico. I talked to a business student last night trying to figure out how to grow and get a new internship this summer. Could I just be somebody that says, I may not know the particularities of your life, but I couldn't be any more proud to say that I am connected to you and you inspire me. Thank you for letting me be a grandpa for a second. You are dearly loved and appreciated. Let me give you some real practical things around campus because we're at the end here. This is the last university passage. There's something the campus pastor's office loves to do. If you have become a Christ follower at APU, if you have found your faith and owned it, God has found you, been chasing after you, and you are at the space where you want to go public for Jesus and do what is talked about in Matthew chapter 28, we do an end of the year baptism every year. If you are interested, come to our office or sign up at the front on West. Pastor Brenda's over there. On East, Pastor Janet's here. These clipboards are up there. If you're interested, come sign up because we'd love to have a conversation with you. If you signed up for this, we don't run to your room and throw a bucket of water on you and say, done, you're baptized. What we want to do is we want you to think through, why would you do this? What does it mean to be a disciple or a follower for your whole life? And you might even find that we try to talk you into going back home and in your local church, if you have one, with your family and with your local pastors, be baptized there, or open to, why would it make sense here? We just love the sacrament of baptism because it is kind of an all-in scenario. If you're interested, that'd be here. Another detail, since this is the last university passage, chapel, I got to get a little details out for you. Next year's university passage, the cornerstone is service. By the way, there couldn't be any better cornerstone for us to focus on for 16-17 than service, because you realize in all fall, there's going to be a political something, a political process, and I don't know how much service is going to be the rhetoric of the day. I've hinted to some of you already, I may talk about the politics of Jesus in fall, but how perfect is it that the cornerstone is service? If you do or don't read your emails, because I know it depends upon the person, you received a personal email from J-Dub, that'd be President John Wallace, telling you that Romans 12 is our university passage next year. A quick preview for you. Imagine if in fall, every one of our political candidates at every level, state and federal, would begin their lives with this. In view of God's mercies, we offer our bodies as living sacrifices. Actually, I won't pick on politics. I'll pick on me and pick on you. What if next year each of us as Christ followers begin every day with offering our bodies as living sacrifices? That's where we're going to be next year and where we're going to be talking. This year, though, we got to finish up. Deuteronomy 6 and Mark 12. I say these phrases so often in chapel because they're true. I am like an intake person, all right? I asked them to leave this slide up for a few minutes here because I want to make sure you catch something. I've been asking some of you what you've heard in these chapels, and there's been a consistency where many of you can name what we've talked about, but you can't remember the references. Can I confess and ask you a question all at the same time? How many of you don't memorize references ever because you got this thing called Google and you say, that passage where it says for us to hear, O Israel. Oh, yeah, Deuteronomy 6. Anybody else guilty? You're all liars. I'm the only one confessing. Will you just look at those references real quick? I really hope. Throw them up one more time. Deuteronomy 6 and Mark 12. If you can stick these somewhere in your memory bank, and you end up in a God conversation with someone, or you have a chance to explain to someone what relationship with God is like, how God is consistent with these themes, Old and New Testament, and what Jesus has done with them. Deuteronomy 6 and Mark 12 would be so good to hold on to. Quick rewind. Mark 12, there's two times that love is brought up. Love twice. Love God and love neighbor. And I joked around last time, love your neighbor for all of our English majors. The role of the mind. Remember, this semester, our cornerstone has been scholarship. I'm finding, as I really spend time trying to figure out what does it mean to love God, that it really requires the engagement of my mind to ask questions like this. The question of who is my neighbor? Last time in the month of March, this is what we talked about. And we talked about loving the one that is most different than us. We talked about loving our enemy. And I had somebody tell me, they're like, we could have done a whole semester on how to love our neighbor. And I agree. But that's where you and your scholarship and your mind can keep engaging the living God and say, God, may your spirit guide me what it means to love others. Because I got ideas and possibilities and a little bit of strength and a little bit of compassion, but I can't love the way that I'm supposed to love without your spirit filling me up and helping me to do that. One of the ways that we said that this would happen would be in patterns and thoughts and feelings and actions. And really want to highlight that again in today's chapel as we finish up the last part of that Mark 12 that we're going to look at, because today we're going to really be checking our motives behind each of these. Motives will be the real focus of today. What does it mean to have a right heart? What does it mean to have a wrong heart? What does it mean to just do something to do something? So I want to bring up those two slides again. When we love, what's important are patterns, thoughts, feelings, and actions. And today I want to make sure that we don't miss out that a lot of that depends upon checking our motives behind each of these. Motives. Let me read to you Mark 12, beginning with verse 32. The really, really smart scholar has already asked Jesus what the two commandments are. Jesus already responded, and here's where we are. Then the scribe said to him, you are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other, and to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself. This is more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. After that, no one dared to ask him any questions. My addition, because they had a whole lot to think about. The bold that you saw in that first slide of scripture is not in our Holy Scriptures. It's me bolding because I want to make sure you know what we're going to focus on and don't want you to miss it. It was the scribe, the scholar saying, these two love actions, these two patterns, these two behaviors, these two are much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. What I don't have time to do today is talk about the whole sacrificial system, but let me hint at this real quick. Some people really wrestle with why sacrifices? What was this? Why did we have to wait for Jesus? You got to remember clear back when we look at Exodus, Deuteronomy, and Leviticus, that when they came up out of Egypt, do you know what kind of patterns and what type of actions and things they had gotten so mixed up with Egypt? I've kind of noticed something about myself and the people I do life with. Do you realize we are all going to worship something? It just seems to be our pattern, whether it's Netflix, whether it's a significant other, whether it's skateboard, or I don't know what it might be, but we all love and worship something. And usually the actions that come out of us show that we worship, how much money we spend on it, how much time we spend on it. And what happened in Leviticus and Deuteronomy is there was a system set up where the people of Israel, when they left Egypt out into the desert, had a way for their sins to be forgiven and a full understanding of what it would mean to put this temple in the center of their community so that God's presence would be the center of who they were and every decision they made would be different than that. What's so great about once Jesus came is Jesus replaced all those systems. All the things that needed to be done through an animal was done through his human and holy God presence being sacrificed on the cross. And so when this scribe, this teacher of the law says, wait a second, loving God and loving neighbor, I got to really pay attention to my motives and how I live. Because I could be doing every right sacrifice, every burnt offering, everything of all those 617 some laws in the Old Testament. I could be doing all of them, the right things. I want to say that, the right things with all the wrong motives. This teacher, this one named Jesus, is rocking my world. Because if I don't have love, they don't mean anything. Here's a really practical way that I think I can describe it for you. I was talking with a bunch of the campus pastors, our grad interns, all of our support staff, and we had this conversation, and they pointed out a couple things that I think is really true for both someone 5 years out of college, 25 years out of college, or even right in the middle of college. We have some systems that so drive us that they kind of define everything. One of the people mentioned in the room that these days everything is automated. You don't have to pay your water bill. You don't have to blink. You don't have to do anything. If you want to make sure you're hydrated, I think there's some water nanny, like you have to keep filling up your plant, which says every time you take a drink, you're being hydrated, right? What they said, though, was I'm at the point now where I don't even see my money make it to my pocket. I don't see it go to the gas company. I don't see it do this, this, and this. Is it possible that with these sacrifices and offerings, do we sometimes move into an automated faith? Oh, yeah, I'm in chapel a couple times. I tithed a little bit. I went to a church. I got three great books and a Bible. Another way that somebody described it, and this is so the academic setting that will make sense to you, do you realize you are always jumping from one goal to the next goal to the next goal? If you're a freshman, you got a goal. You need to get to the sophomore year. If you were recently in high school, you got a goal, finish up high school and get to college. If you're finishing up college, you got a new goal. It's get a job or get a graduate degree, right? I mean, there's always this what's next, what's next, what's next. Do you know in this sacrificial system or a thing that I'll call religiosity, it's also really possible to always be about what's next. I got to finish this and move to that. Take all the love, all the relationship, all of that out of that. It could be, I just got to get what's next. Here's another one that was mentioned that you might identify. Do any of you live with a pattern called good enough submit? Right? You know what I'm talking about? You get to that point, someone's like, yeah, that's me, right? Yeah, good enough, submit. I'm gonna be just to the point honest. I assume you may do that with our faith journey as well. Good enough, submit. The other one that I was able to identify can kind of point to the relationships that I'm in with people sometimes, and that is the I need to stay out of trouble. What should I do? I don't know if there's any significant relationships or friendships that right now you might be looking going, I know my friend really likes it when I do these things, but I hate doing those things, but it will make our relationship easier, so I'll just do it. Or if somebody's interested in somebody and they know the other likes flowers, they hate buying flowers, but they'll buy flowers, or stealing them from the Rose Garden at APU. There are some patterns in our lives that don't we sometimes do relationships out of how do I stay out of trouble? That is not Mark 12. And that is not what the scribe was doing. We want to err on the side of satire this morning. Grad interns and our media director really spent a lot of time dreaming up. A couple of our pastors are really tried to think through what might this look in life. And we came up with a video that many said, whoa, that is so funny. That could be an end of the year chapel, which is good. Humor's great. Satire's important. What was also said about the video is, oh my word, I know five people that live like that, which hinges on judgment or scapegoating, get out of the way, somebody else. Here's what I want to do. I want to show this very creative video that they came up with, acknowledge that it's satire, but give you a warning. If you keep yourself out of this video, you will miss the whole point. The question is it possible that any of us may live either in exaggerated ways like this or subtle ways like this? Is it possible that any of us sometimes act like we wish we had a InstaFaith app? Check out this video.
For me, the biggest issue has always been that I'm doing these good Christian things. How do I know if I'm really growing and maturing spiritually? It's been like a really big bummer. But then my friends told me about InstaFaith.
The central driving passion that really gave birth to InstaFaith is the same passion that keeps it going today, which is, how can I, when I lay my head on my pillow at night, convince myself that I'm a good person and a good Christian? Before, it mostly involved some combination of self-deception and cognitive dissonance. Now, InstaFaith does that for users, and we couldn't be more thrilled about the impact it's having across America.
I love InstaFaith because it's so easy to use. I just take a picture, like for example, of going to chapel or studying for my exegetical paper, post it to InstaFaith, and the faith points tell me exactly where I'm at spiritually. Thanks, InstaFaith.
Theologians tell us that the Bible is divinely inspired. Well, so is InstaFaith. We built InstaFaith with a proprietary technology that we call FaithSense. It analyzes your photo uploads and detects faith-building behaviors, and then awards you a faith points value based upon the photo's OR, which stands for objective righteousness.
No more guessing, no more messiness, no more late-night existential crisis wondering, have I done enough? Tracking your progress with InstaFaith is easy. For every 1,000 faith points you earn, a fish or a loaf of bread will be added to your daily basket. When you fill your basket completely, you're good for the day.
I love that InstaFaith is a social app too. So like today about lunchtime, my friend will send me a faith push saying, I don't have many faith points for today. So that's when I get really obsessed with the unlocking stacking feature that lets me multiply my faith points. So things like prayer chapel, having my Bible open in John 3:16, my cheesy Christian t-shirt, boom, that means 6 times the faith points and I'm right back where I'm supposed to be with my faith.
At the end of a long day, I often realize, wow, I've been a super jerk to my roommates and pretty much just focused exclusively on my own interests. But InstaFaith reminds me that I also went to chapel, had 2 Bible classes, and overheard my roommates praying for a while earlier. That's what's so great about this app. It doesn't matter how it happens. As long as my InstaFaith basket is filled with bread and fishies by sundown, I can feel good about myself.
InstaFaith came to my rescue in my time of need. Now, it's not the only way to make sure that you're spiritually good to go. It's just the one that requires the least amount of actual life change. Thanks, InstaFaith.
InstaFaith is here to change the entire world. Not only have we succeeded in making faith easy, we've also made it fun. So do yourself a favor and try InstaFaith today. Is your faith InstaFaith?
Wow. Ouch. Satire at a very, very personal place. Please don't just think about other people. Please don't just say, that was so funny, what a great thing, I can't wait to look it up to see if it really exists. Please don't quickly move on, but ask, where might that be subversively, casually happening that I'm not even aware of in my life, or maybe even directly, God, give me wisdom. Many of the things that were mentioned in there, I think done with a right heart, God works through relationship. There was no intentional purpose to pick on one single thing. It was more, what does it look like when the motivation is wrong, when the heart is wrong, when religiosity is now the how do I stack up and stay out of trouble, jump to the next goal, that automated good enough, submit. What does it look like for us to really be passionate about a life with Christ? One of the thoughts that I had is if you understand the date and the time that Mark was probably written, it was probably around 70 AD, or if you like common era, CE. What was going on at that time was the temple area was used as kind of a place for about 4 years where many of the Jewish revolt would be hiding, taking care of, and eventually the Romans took care of it and trashed it and everything else. And so the destruction of the temple would have been in the mind of the author as this was written. And when I was in Rome recently, I had a chance to see what's called the Arch of Titus, and what was carved out long time ago is an exact real piece of what it would have looked like with the menorah being taken off, with the showbread table, the trumpets, all the religious normal things that were the center of faith were destroyed and taken away. And if the author of Mark was writing this at that same time period and new Christians or potential Christians were reading this, they would have probably seen this passage and said, what Jesus was talking about, what the scribe was talking about is, what does this faith look like even when all the conveniences of a great religion are now gone? Will there still be love in radical ways? I started to think about it this way for myself. Love the local church. I love APU, what it stands for. I love being able to have Bibles, and it's great to be able to look up a podcast and all of that. What if we were all stripped of every part of religious system? Not because it was bad, but what if it was just taken away for us? What kind of faith would we be able to have? Is love so integrated in us that we would still find ways to be intimate this way? Some of you have a small little thing coming up called graduation, and where chapel may feel like, man, I've done it 4 years, I'm so done with it. I've been shocked how many students say they miss gathering with a group of people and really worshiping and hearing the word consistently. I love it. You grow out of chapel. You're supposed to. If you want to stay here forever, we didn't do our job, and you didn't use your mind and heart to grow in God. But what you might miss is Christian community or being challenged. But the question in this passage is, you shouldn't have to have those things to be in deep relationship this way and to love radically this way. This passage challenges me so much what it means to live deep with God. I want to give you a couple examples that are personal, but this is not prescriptive. Don't do this like me. This is more descriptive, some of the ways that I've had to wrestle with this and kind of think this through. As I've studied this, one of the things that I've noticed with my wife and I is we believe scripture deeply that our money is a gift and tithing is important. The way churches work and donation places around the world work this day, you can be so automated that you can set 10%, 9.5%, 11%, and never think ever again about anywhere your money goes. It's not evil. It's actually a real convenience. Imagine money going to other parts of the world. But what does a spirit-filled relationship life look like where I am so vested in where that money goes that I am deeply praying for them, caring about where that makes a difference, and even saying, God, give me wisdom if that's supposed to go somewhere else? What would it look like to carry an extra 3, 4, 5% in my pocket and always be living in such a way that says, God, when I come across somebody, let me be ready for your spirit getting my attention to be able to hand off money because this is your money. I can't believe you're only asking for 10%. Help me to live in this deeply. I do not want to stand before my maker someday and go, oh, God, it was automated 10% every year since 2002. Again, automated isn't bad, but it could take away what this relationship piece looks like. Let me give you another radical one that happened a few years after I was out of college, because religiosity is something we all struggle with in the sense that sometimes we're just ready to buck the system and totally be done with it, angry, mad at it. I remember being freed up in 1992 feeling like I can follow Jesus casually. I grew up in a church that was very dressy, and they liked to wear nice clothes. And I'm like, nah, that's not me. That's not where God's at. I'm just going to be myself. And I had a chance to volunteer and work with some senior adults. And it was so interesting because in that time that I was there, I was really loving those senior adults and participating with them. And I had a chance to talk to them. And afterwards, somebody came up to me and said, Woody, I can tell that you deeply love us. But do you realize today in your flip-flops, your shorts, your religious freedom of wearing a hat in church, you had a bunch of senior adults who live in such a manner that they didn't hear a single word you said. Now, they have to deal with that on their own. That's their issue. But this person that was so good to me said, in your love of others, when will there be sacrifice that even though you feel comfortable wearing a hat in church or flip-flops, say, I care more deeply about loving my neighbor and watching out for them that I won't even use that right? Man, that totally changed how I even try to buck off religiosity. Because I love being free in Christ, but I don't want to use that freedom now to harm my brother and sister, or even take away my voice for having a chance to communicate. Here's another silly one. Again, don't do these things. These are the ones I'm working on. I have a stack of favorite books, right? And every time I walk into my office, I go, oh, those ones changed me radically. Those shaped me. I live differently. I love those books. Do you realize no matter how good these books are or any others, if I don't figure out what it means to be in a living, active, faithing, ING space with God and with others, that stack of books in my office or at my home or in my dorm room are nothing more than a form of religiosity that makes me feel like I'm okay because I got that knowledge. I want to live it. I want to faithing. I want to what it means to be actively figuring this out through the whole process. There's two passages, and I won't even do them justice. And so I just want to mention them to you. Oh, I want you to see the first slide of this one. An example of a wrongly motivated heart. Jesus calls out the scribes. If you have time later today, I would love for you to read what comes after this part, because Jesus basically points out that they love to pray in public. They love to show off. They love to do everything. And the line I came up with this. The Pharisees, or they, love status and recognition more than God. I'm guilty of that sometimes. Is anybody else? And then the final story in this whole thing is an example of a rightly motivated heart, the widow's offering. There is this poor widow that sacrificially gives everything. The line I came up with this is, the widow lived out love in sacrificial devotion. It's really weird. The scribe says, I guess the burnt offerings and sacrifice aren't important, yet the story of the widow is, you can't have love without sacrificing yourself. Ritualistic or religiosity type sacrifice doesn't mean anything, but a life full of love will be sacrifice in every way. I got a friend that's gonna join me this morning, because you don't need to hear my examples. Ilse, come on up, grab a microphone. Ilse is a graduating senior this May. And I got to read a questionnaire that you filled out. And the questionnaire was describing her faith journey. And when I read it, I knew it was a perfect fit for this morning, because she was talking about how she became aware of doing many of the right things in the Christian faith out of the wrong motive. Will you tell everybody a little bit about what you wrote about?
So I wrote about how I grew up in a Christian home, and how because of that, I really wanted or felt like I needed to be this perfect kid, not necessarily for me, but just so that my family could have that, like, oh, look, we're Christian. Our kid knows all the Jesus Bible answers. So I started just doing things to kind of prove to people that my family and that I was Christian.
And you kind of told me in our conversation that a lot of that came out of a deep respect and love. So it's kind of, it's weird how religiosity can be based in a lot of really good, healthy things, but it didn't really give you life, did it? It started really messing you up. There was one example you gave. What was the thing that you did? Oh, you did a D group because you felt like it would show your parents that you're a Christ follower. It would show yourself that you're a Christ follower. But what happened with that D group?
I actually ended up hating everyone in my D group.
Yeah,
hating that I had.
You gotta love honesty.
I just was so annoyed. Even like every time we had D group, I was like, I hate this. Yeah. And I'm pretty sure these girls hate me because like we're all just here because we have to be, not because we want to be. Yeah.
A wrongly motivated heart can ruin the worst thing, you know? Yeah. What shifted for you? You've been at APU for 4 years. And at APU, not everybody has decided to follow Jesus. And so if anybody in here is at that place where they're like, I'm not bought in, I'm thinking about it, I'm not sure, I'm actually really turned off. If you see our fakeness, our religiosity, I'm sorry, we are also trying to figure this out. And there's a lot of you who have been Christians your whole life and you're here, and I don't want you to go 4 years without figuring out what it means to have a rightly motivated heart, to follow Jesus and be ready for the Spirit to come and speak to you and shape you. What was it that shifted for you? Because if you were still doing all those things out of just trying to please others and make it look like you're right, you'd still be really miserable and hating everybody because it doesn't work that way. What shifted? What was the twist?
I think I came to a point in my community and with friends where I started realizing that God loved me just because that's like who he is, and that I didn't have to do anything to try to prove to him that I was worth loving or worth whatever. Like that I didn't have to prove that I deserved Jesus dying on the cross for me, but he did that just because he loves. And so when I realized that God loved me, everything became a response to that love. So I lived out of like loving him back instead of obligation, which I thought was better.
What was crazy about your story is it hinted in there that you actually at the church ended up doing a D group later, and what were the results in a different heart-motivated place?
Yeah, it was, I love them. I love the girls that I have now. I know, from hate to love. But I do, like, because everyone that is there, starting with me, is there just because we want to love Jesus more, so I don't feel like I have to prove anything to them. Yep. All we're doing is like, you know, in our weakness and in our brokenness, following Jesus together, which is so much better than like us trying to go there to like check a box.
Ilse did a great job describing it, didn't she? Will we give her a hand? This is a journey. Two suggestions, and then we're going to do a short prayer, and you're going to get out of here. Between now and the end of May, because some of you have space in May, I would love to call you to reflect on your life and ask, why am I doing what I'm doing? I'd love for you to check your motives. If you'd bow your heads, Ilse and I would love to pray for you.
God, we just thank you for APU and for the opportunity that we have to follow you together as a community. We ask that you would just show us how much you love us and that we don't have to do anything to earn your love or to check boxes on some list. And we pray that you would give us the grace to love you and to love our neighbors better. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Get out of here. Have a great day.